Random House Audio presents Guilt, an Alex Delaware novel by Jonathan Kellerman. Read for you by John Rubinstein. All mine. The house. The life growing inside her. The husband. Holly finished her fifth circuit of the back room that looked out to the yard. She paused for breath. The baby, Amy, had started pushing against her diaphragm. Since escrow had closed, Holly had done 100 circuits, imagining, loving every inch of the place, despite the odors embedded in 90-year-old plaster, cat pee, mildew, overripe vegetable soup. Old person. In a few days, the painting would begin, and the aroma of fresh latex would bury all that, and cheerful colors would mask the discouraging gray beige of Holly's 10-room dream, not counting bathrooms. The house was a brick-faced Tudor on a quarter-acre lot at the southern edge of Cheviot Hills, built when construction was meant to last, and adorned by moldings, wainscoting, arched mahogany doors, quarter-sawn oak floors. Parquet in the cute little study that would be Matt's home office when he needed to bring work home. Holly could close the door and not have to hear Matt's grumbling about moron clients incapable of keeping decent records. Meanwhile, she'd be on a comfy couch, snuggling with Amy. She'd learned the sex of the baby at the 4-month anatomical ultrasound, decided on the name right then and there. Matt didn't know yet. He was still adjusting to the whole fatherhood thing. Resting her hands on a mahogany sill, Holly squinted to blank out the weeds and dead grass, struggling to conjure a green, flower-laden Eden. Hard to visualize with a mountain of tree trunk taking up all that space. The 5-story sycamore had been one of the house's selling points, with its trunk as thick as an oil drum and dense foliage that created a moody, almost spooky ambience. Holly's creative powers had immediately kicked into gear, visualizing a swing attached to that swooping lower branch. Amy giggling as she swooped up and shouted that Holly was the best mommy. 2 weeks into escrow, during a massive, unseasonal rainstorm, the sycamore's roots had given way. Thank God the monster had teetered but hadn't fallen. The trajectory would have landed it right on the house. An agreement was drawn up. The sellers, the old woman's son and daughter, would pay to have the monstrous thing chopped down and hauled away, the stump ground to dust, the soil leveled. Instead, they'd cheaped out, paying a tree company only to cut down the sycamore, leaving behind a massive horror of deadwood that took up the entire rear half of the yard. Matt had gone bananas, threatened to kill the deal. Abrogate. What an ugly word. Holly had cooled him off by promising to handle the situation. She'd make sure they got duly compensated. He wouldn't have to deal with it. Fine. As long as you actually do it. Now Holly stared at the mountain of wood, feeling discouraged and a bit helpless. Some of the sycamore, she supposed, could be reduced to firewood. Fragments and leaves and loose pieces of bark she could rake up herself, maybe create a compost pile. But those massive columns. Whatever, she'd figure it out. Meanwhile, there was cat pee, overripe soup, mildew, old lady stink to deal with. She struggled with a bulky old brass handle, original hardware, shoved a warped French door open, and stepped out into the yard. Making her way through the obstacle course of felled branches, death-browned leaves, and ragged pieces of bark, she reached the fence that separated her property from the neighbor's. This was her first serious look at the mess, and it was even worse than she'd thought. The tree company had sawed away with abandon, allowing the chunks to fall on unprotected ground. The result was a whole bunch of holes, craters, a real disaster. She kneeled at the rim of the grossest crater, tugged at the roots. No give. Moving to a smaller pit, she dislodged only dust. At the third hole, as she managed to tug loose a thatch of smaller roots, her fingers brushed against something cold. Metallic. Buried treasure. Aye, aye, pirate booty. Wouldn't that be justice? Laughing, Holly brushed away soil and rocks, revealed a patch of pale blue. Then a red cross. A few more strokes, and the entire top of the metal thing came into view. A box, like a safe deposit box, but larger. Blue, except for the red cross at the center. Something medical? Or just kids burying who knew what in an abandoned receptacle? Holly tried to budge the box. It shimmied, but held fast. She rocked it back and forth, made some progress, but was unable to free the darn thing. Then she remembered, and went to the garage and retrieved the ancient spade from the stack of rusty tools left behind by the sellers. Returning to the hole, she wedged the spade's flat mouth between metal and dirt and put a little weight into the pry. A creak sounded, but the box only budged a tiny bit, stubborn devil. She worked the spade some more. On her next try, the box's left side popped up and flew out of the hole, and Holly staggered back, caught off balance. She recovered enough to drag the blue box onto the dirt. No lock on the latch, just a hasp and loop, rusted through. But the rest of the box had turned green from oxidation, and a patch worn through the blue paint explained that. Bronze. From the weight, solid. That had to be worth something by itself. Holly jiggled with the hasp until she freed it. Presto gizmo, she said, lifting the lid. The bottom and sides of the box were lined with browned newspaper. Resting in the nest of clippings was something wrapped in fuzzy cloth, a satin-edged blanket, once blue, now faded mostly to tan and pale green. Purplish splotches on the satin borders. Something worth wrapping. Burying. Excited, Holly lifted the blanket out of the box. Feeling disappointed immediately because whatever was inside had no serious weight to it. Scratched doubloons or gold bars or rose-cut diamonds. Laying the blanket on the ground, Holly took hold of a seam and unfurled. The thing that had been inside the blanket grinned up at her. Then it shape-shifted, oh God, and she cried out and it fell apart in front of her eyes, because all that had held it together was the tension of the blanket wrap. Tiny skeleton, now a scatter of loose bones. The skull had landed right in front of her, smiling. Black eye holes insanely piercing. Two minuscule tooth thingies on the bottom jaw looked ready to bite. Holly sat there, unable to move or breathe or think. A bird peeped. Silence bore down on Holly. A leg bone rolled to one side, as if by its own power, and she let out a wordless retch of fear and revulsion. That did nothing to discourage the skull. It kept staring, like it knew something. Holly mustered all of her strength and screamed, kept screaming. The woman was blonde, pretty, white-faced, pregnant. Her name was Holly Roosh, and she sat hunched atop a tree stump, one of a dozen or so massive chainsawed segments taking up a good portion of the run-down backyard. Breathing hard and clutching her belly, she clenched her eyes shut. One of Milo's cards rested between her right thumb and forefinger, crumpled beyond recognition. For the second time since I'd arrived, she waved off help from the paramedics. They hung around anyway, paying scant attention to the uniforms and the coroner's crew. Everyone standing around looked superfluous. It would take an anthropologist to make sense of this. Milo had phoned the EMTs first.
Priorities. It's not like there's any emergency to the rest of it.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.